The unleashed power of the atom has changed everything save our modes of thinking, and we thus drift toward unparalleled catastrophe. So that's what we decided needed to be done. We have to change the way we think and realize that war is obsolete as a way of resolving conflict.
What nuclear winter is about is extremely simple. Fundamentally, what it says is that there will be a large number of fine particles, dust particles, smoke, soot, put into the lower atmosphere and the upper atmosphere that simply blocks the sun. So it means no food, no water, and lots of freezing to death.
The question I'm going to address is, how probable is global nuclear war? And the answer is, it's not just low probability, it's not just high probability, it's 100% certain. It's inevitable.
On a clear day, a working day, let's say a Monday, in dry weather, at about 3 o'clock, in short, let's say today, now, at this moment. I draw your attention to the map. That first circle, this is for 1 megaton airburst, remember, with a radius of about 1.5 miles, is an area in which the overpressures are 20 pounds per square inch, which will destroy everything. Winds are 500 miles an hour. Reinforced concrete and steel buildings of the strongest construction will either collapse totally or have all of their floors swept out from within the structure. The heat is such that most everybody will be either vaporized or killed by third-degree burns, if indeed they're not killed by other trauma.
The first in a four-part series on war and how the world can move beyond war. The first program is on the threat and consequences of nuclear war. Tonight, on Alternative Views. Good evening. Alternative Views is starting a special four-part series on war, what it's like, different aspects of it, what we can do about it, some of the changes that are going to have to be made before we can really do something basic to end war. We're going to be spending this time not only looking at some very interesting and moving documentaries, very informative as well. We'll also be presenting information that perhaps you might have seen before on Alternative Views. But we also have with us Barbara Carlson, who's the Texas coordinator of the Beyond War Foundation and on the board of directors of the National Beyond War Foundation. It's a very interesting group and one which is growing in the peace movement tremendously. It has a very special appeal to it. Barbara, we're glad you can join us in this. We're going to be here for four programs and really going in quite depth about war. Mm-hmm. And your organization, Beyond War, also looks at it in depth, too. Tell us a little bit about Beyond War.
All right. Well, I lived in Palo Alto, California in 1982, in the early 1982, and a group of us went to see a film at Stanford called The Last Epidemic, and I'm sure you're familiar with that film. But it talks about the medical consequences of a nuclear war. And I was very shocked by what I saw, and most of us that went that evening were. We had certainly considered ourselves aware individuals and people that were involved in our communities and so forth, but we had not realized the magnitude of the problem of war and nuclear war. So we came away from that evening saying we had to do something and make a response to what we'd seen. And so we spent a period of 3 to 6 months where we tried to gather information. We interviewed people around the country, people that have been concerned about this issue for a long time, people on the streets, what are people thinking. We made a trip to Washington, D.C., a couple of trips, and talked to people in the Pentagon and our representatives, and always asking the questions, what's going on, and what can we do, and what are people thinking. We came away with two basic thoughts. One of them was that this problem is not going to be solved in Washington. That isn't where things start. That's where things end. And that really it's the people that have to make some kind of a response. And secondly, that education was critical. Most people are not aware. They were like us. They weren't aware, aren't aware of the magnitude of this problem and the seriousness of it. So we decided to launch a movement. And we called it Beyond War, meaning that we have to move beyond war as a way of resolving conflict, that nuclear weapons had changed everything. And we found a wonderful quote from Einstein early on that says something he said in 1946 in a telegram he sent to scientists and engineers around the country. He said, "The unleashed power of the atom has changed everything save our modes of thinking, and we thus drift toward unparalleled catastrophe." So that's what we decided needed to be done. We have to change the way we think and realize that war is obsolete as a way of resolving conflict.
Let's take a look at a portion of the last epidemic so people can kind of understand what caused your conversion and created this whole new dimension of your life.
Mm-hmm. What will happen to San Francisco in the event of a specified nuclear attack? What will happen to its people? What will happen to its physical environment? What will happen to its biological environment? What will happen to its structure of medical care? Hiroshima was 12 and a half to 15 kilotons. At 1 megaton on San Francisco or any other population center, we are trying to imagine 70 Hiroshima bombs all at once, all in one place. Let me turn first to the specifiable events. A single explosion, an airburst at 7,000 feet over downtown San Francisco in the fall on a clear day, a working day, let's say a Monday, in dry weather at about 3 o'clock. In short, let's say today, now, at this moment. I draw your attention to the map. That first circle, this is for 1 megaton airburst, remember, with a radius of about 1.5 miles, is an area in which the overpressures are 20 pounds per square inch, which will destroy everything. Winds are 500 miles an hour. Reinforced concrete and steel buildings of the strongest construction will either collapse totally or have all of their floors swept out from within the structure. The heat is such that most everybody will be either vaporized or killed by third-degree burns, if indeed they're not killed by other trauma. Circle 2, with a radius of 3 miles, has overpressures of 10 pounds per square inch, winds at 160 miles an hour, brick and wood frame houses destroyed, exposed people seriously burned. And I'll just mention one thing about overpressures of anywhere from 0.5 pound per square inch to 2 pounds per square inch. It'll take a glass window and turn it into 1,000 particles of glass traveling at an excess of 100 miles an hour. The winds create a low pressure area as they move outward. Surrounding air rushes in, fanning the many fires started by the thermal radiation and initial blast damage. One can expect these kinds of fires for a radius of anywhere from 8 to 16 miles, depending on the megatonnage. Firestorms of this type, aside from Hiroshima, developed after a series of conventional air raids on Hamburg in 1943, Leipzig, and Dresden. They produce temperatures estimated at 800 degrees centigrade, 1,472 degrees Fahrenheit. Days after the raid, as some shelters were open, enough heat was found to have remained so that the influx of oxygen caused the entire shelter to burst into flames. What a firestorm does is increase the lethal area of a nuclear attack for a single bomb fivefold. The more important point in terms of some dreams of civil defense planning and the like is that in Hamburg and Leipzig, the only people who survived were those who fled their shelters. not those who entered or stayed in them, because the shelters simply turned into crematoria at those temperatures. At 1 megaton in an airburst, of the 3,613,000 people in the San Francisco metropolitan area, 780,000 would be killed outright. The total casualties are 1,162,500 people, almost precisely every third person. Let me turn briefly to the types of injuries you have already today heard about, some of them. Overwhelmingly, first of all, third-degree burns. Certainly thousands, probably tens of thousands, in the case of the multiple 20 megatons explosions, in the hundreds of thousands. And that, of course, exceeds by thousands, by orders of magnitude, the total number of burn beds in the United States, let alone in the San Francisco metropolitan Bay Area. Second-degree burns, of course, on top of those. Crushing injuries due to the collapse of buildings and related kinds of trauma, ruptured internal organs, especially rupture of the lungs, penetrating wounds of the skull, the thorax, and the abdomen because all kinds of objects have been turned into missiles traveling at high speeds, simple and compound fractures of all kinds, including skull fractures, because people have been turned into missiles traveling at high speeds until they hit the nearest hard object, wall, or whatever, and of course hemorrhage. And of course, all of the above in combination. And two things that aren't mentioned very often, significant numbers among the wounded survivors who will be deaf because of ruptured eardrums, and even larger numbers who will be blind. Anybody within 35 miles down as far as San Jose in the south, well into Marin County in the north, 35 miles to the east, who makes a reflex glance at the fireball, and there will be many such people at distances up to 35 miles, as a probability of being blinded by retinal burning. Say a word about the radiation effects without being too redundant. It will be impossible for anybody to distinguish on the basis of symptomatology between people who have had only 100 rems and might survive with adequate care and people who have had 1,000 rems and are not going to survive no matter what anybody does with whatever kinds of resources. But again, to talk of response becomes a kind of absurdity and a kind of delusion again when we look at the data. Who will respond? And what will they have to respond with? Physicians and hospitals, as has been mentioned, are destroyed at rates greater than that of the population because they tend to be concentrated in downtown urban areas in the zones of highest lethality. And it is a conservative calculation, without taking you through every detail, that there would be less than 2,000 physicians in the San Francisco metropolitan area, the area that we're talking about in terms of the population base, able to function. And there would be fewer than 2,000 beds. If every physician spent only 10 minutes on the diagnosis and treatment of each patient, and work 20 hours every day. At 1 to 1,000, it would be 8 days before every injured person is seen for the first time by a physician for 10 minutes. But there is a further dimension in which this estimate is meaningless, because it is talking of physicians or other health workers working without equipment, without diagnostic aids, without laboratories, without therapeutic resources, without blood or plasma, without caches of blood supplies, or any of the other things that are needed for contemporary medical management of trauma, burns, or even lesser injuries. So the effectiveness of that 10-minute diagnostic and therapeutic visit is likely to be almost zero. You must remember that there will be no electric power. There will be no water. There will be no transportation system. Most of the buildings and streets and geography and terrain will be unrecognizable. There will be no organized systems of communication. And I remind you, in the scenario we are describing, there is no probability of help from outside. What this means, in sum, is that most of the seriously injured persons will never see a physician or other health worker, even for the simple administration of narcotics for their pain, before they die. And it seems to me highly probable that the survivors will envy the dead. The only true meaning of survival in complex urban industrial societies is not mere biological survival, it is social survival. The biological survivors, in fact, have all, in all probability, merely postponed by days, weeks, months, at most a few years, their deaths from secondary attack-related causes. Some conclusions. There is no survival in any sense of that word that has social meaning from a nuclear attack. Mass evacuation provides no rational basis for planning for survival. I testified not long ago before a Senate hearing at which the successors to that set of Office of Civil Defense Mobilization people, now called the Federal Emergency Management Program, testified, and they said cheerfully for a specifiable nuclear attack that they already had plans that would take care of 7% of the population, and if they were just given enough funding and a little time, they could work out plans to protect up to 80% of the United States population in the event of an all-out nuclear exchange. One of the senators asked them what technique they had in mind. They answered mass evacuation, of course. And they were asked how long notice would they require to effect such a plan successfully, and they said only 8 days. It is my belief that any physician who even takes part in so-called emergency medical disaster planning specifically to meet the problem of nuclear attack, any physician who even takes part in such an activity is committing a profoundly unethical act. He is deluding himself or herself, colleagues, and by implication the public at large into the false belief that mechanisms of survival in any meaningful social sense are possible.
Barbara, I think to change people's ways of thinking, you have to shock them first. And I think the last epidemic does this magnificently by graphically demonstrating the horrors of nuclear war. It shows the magnitude of the danger. And I think the next step, though, is to get information. One has to understand what brought about the arms race, what brought about the current catastrophic situation where we have so many nuclear weapons we could end life on Earth as it has. How do you go about educating people once you've sort of shocked them into the dangers?
Well, there's a lot of aspects of it. I agree with you. I think people have to take a hard look at the problem and really see how severe it is. But there was an interesting thing we learned early on, that if people do not see hope at the same time they're looking at the problem, they can't take in the magnitude of the problem. I mean, I've seen that for myself. Because it's almost like you protect yourself psychically. If you really realize that we could destroy all of life with these weapons, if you take that in and you don't see any way to make a difference, you would probably go crazy. And so we have been very concerned about having people see at the same time the problem, seeing that they actually can make a difference and there are things individuals can do and there is hope, that we have made huge changes in the past in the way we've thought, and that we have the capacity to do that, and we are capable of doing anything we make up our minds to do, really. And
you know, the whole idea of nuclear war is so huge, so immense, it's difficult to grasp.
It is.
And also the amount of arms, of nuclear arms, that is so disproportionately large to the amount of destruction that would be required to wipe out the human race.
In this regard, Daniel Ellsberg compares the atomic bombs with the nuclear bombs we have now.
Nagasaki bomb was a plutonium bomb, only now it's for the trigger of a bomb that's 1,000 times more powerful. We have, they say, 9,200 other strategic warheads. Not counting, as it's common to omit these, not counting the 22,000 little Nagasaki-sized weapons.
The book, Trim Tab Factor, has a chart which shows the world's current firepower as opposed to the firepower of World War II. The dot in the center represents all of the firepower in World War II, 3 megatons. The other dots represent the world's present nuclear weaponry, which equals 6,000 World War IIs, or 18,000 megatons. The U.S. and the Soviets share this firepower with approximately equal destructive capability. The top left-hand circle, enclosing 9 megatons, represents the weapons on just one Poseidon submarine. Now, this is equal to the firepower of 3 World War IIs and enough to destroy over 200 of the Soviets' largest cities and one submarine. We have 31 such subs and 10 similar Polaris subs. There's a circle in the left-hand square enclosing 24 megatons, representing one new Trident submarine with a firepower of 8 World War IIs, enough to destroy every major city in the Northern Hemisphere. The Soviets have similar levels of destructive power. So just 2 squares on this chart, or 300 megatons, represent enough firepower to destroy all of the large and medium-sized cities in the entire world.
Every president in every term of office since nuclear weapons were invented has considered seriously the imminent use of those nuclear weapons.
It's a strange, strange thing. What is the thinking behind it, you suppose? Why are the attitudes that, what are the attitudes that cause this?
Well, I think if you consider the fact that we have warred for 10,000 years, social scientists tell us that they believe war began when we went from the nomadic society into developing plots of ground and actually staying in one place. And there were boundaries and borders that were established for people's territories. And that was the beginning of war some 10,000 years ago. So you say, well, for 10,000 years, war has worked, whatever that means. I mean, certainly there have always been people that have paid the price for war, but there have been a winner and there has been a loser.
And there have been benefits to the winners.
And definitely. There have been benefits to the winners. Someone has gone walked away with the spoils.
And even the participants. I mean, it was one thing to
heroes.
Be able to recruit an army. It was easier to recruit an army back in those days because the individual soldiers could get a piece of the pie, too, if
right.
they were on the winning
exactly.
side and survive.
So you can see that if you consider it, of course we would be thinking this way now because it has worked for 10,000 years. So the change that we're trying to make is a huge one. It's a big change in our way of thinking. And you can understand why we built the weapons, because it's been the way we've operated. But that doesn't mean we can't change it, and it doesn't mean we won't change it, and we absolutely have got to change it if we're going to survive.
That's true. Some statisticians have done studies on the inevitability of nuclear war, mm-hmm. and Beyond War has made a little documentary or study by a...
Yes, there's a man at Stanford. His name is Dr. Martin Hellman, and he is a statistician, and he has used the analogy of Russian roulette to make the point of that if we continue with deterrence, that it's like playing Russian roulette, because every small war, every chance of an accident, every new weapon that we build where something could go wrong, it leads us closer and closer to the inevitability of something happening and going wrong. It's a very powerful little film.
Let's see it.
Okay.
Dr. Martin E. Hellman is professor of electrical engineering at Stanford University and a world-renowned authority on cryptography and statistics.
The question I'm going to address is, how probable is global nuclear war? And the answer is, it's not just low probability, it's not just high probability, it's 100% certain. It's inevitable. To understand why, it helps to consider a model. We call it a two-state Markov process. And in this model, we think of the world as being in one of two states. a state of global war. This is where the world was during World War I and during World War II. The only other state that the world has been in up till now is a state of armed defense. This state is not peace, but neither is it global war. This is the state the world had been in up till 1914. We'd never had a global war. In 1914, a move was made into the state of global war. That's when World War I started. And in 1918, a move was made back. World War I ended, and we moved back into the state of armed defense. Then World War II started in 1939. And again, the world moved from here over to here. In 1945, World War II ended, and we moved back into the state of armed defense. But in 1945, with the unleashing of the atom, everything changed. In the words of General Douglas MacArthur, global war became a Frankenstein that could only destroy both sides. And here's a way to picture that. We still have the two possible states of armed defense and global war. But the state of global war is shown in red to denote that it is so destructive that really there's no return from it. And you can picture that diagrammatically by drawing an arrow. It's still possible to go from where we are now into the state of global war, but it's no longer possible to come back. There is no return arrow. The state of global war is an absorbing state in the terminology of Markov chains. It's a one-way street. It's a state of no return. Now, there's a very surprising and a very dangerous property associated with this new diagram. It doesn't matter how small the probability of transition into the state of global war is. So long as it's bigger than zero, the probability of eventually ending up in the global war state, of annihilating ourselves, is 100%. The probability builds up over time. Now, to understand how that works, it helps to consider an imaginary game, a suicidal game, in which I take a coin out of my pocket and I'm going to toss it. And the first time it shows heads, I get shot. So in terms of these two states, this is where I am right now. I'm alive, and every time I toss the coin, there's a 50% chance that I get killed, that I die, and I end up over here. So this is the death state. And once I'm over here, there's no return. There's no way to come back. So here goes. Tails. I was lucky. So I play the game again. Got a second tail. I've been very lucky. But common sense tells you that if I keep playing this game, that eventually a head is going to come up. There's 100% probability that it will happen eventually and that I will die. This coin tossing game is a form of Russian roulette, except the probability of my being shot each time is 50% instead of one chance in six. In normal Russian roulette, what we do is I take a revolver with six chambers, and I empty it, and I put one bullet back in one of the chambers. I spin it, and I put it to my head, and I pull the trigger. And you see, there's one chance in six of being killed each time. And again, common sense tells you that if I continually play Russian roulette, I continually spin the spindle, pull the trigger, the outcome is 100% certain. I get shot. It doesn't matter whether the probability is 50% or one chance in six, or if it gets even smaller, one chance in 60, like with a 60-chambered revolver, or one chance in 600. The outcome is the same. Inevitably, I get shot. Now, no one in their right mind would play Russian roulette continually. Yet we are continually playing nuclear roulette. That's a version of Russian roulette in which the entire world is at stake. And we've pulled the trigger in that game way too often. Every small war is pulling the trigger. Every threat of the use of violence is pulling the trigger. Every day that goes by in which a computer or a missile could fail is pulling the trigger. If we keep taking low probability chances, the probability of World War III isn't low. It's certain. It's inevitable. The only way to survive Russian roulette is to stop playing the game, to put down the gun. In the same way, the only way to survive nuclear roulette is to stop playing the game, to put down the gun globally, to move beyond war. What we need to do is to add a third possible state that's never existed before. A world beyond war. Moves into this new state must be a one-way street also. We must decide to totally reject all war as an option. Unless we make that total shift in our mode of thinking, World War III is inevitable.
Barbara, I think that the new way of thinking that you're talking about is necessitated by the very fact of nuclear war. In a nuclear era, war is really unthinkable because it would be so catastrophic. So that people need to retool their thinking to think about peace and survival. You can't really think of war as a strategic element of politics or of winning a war because there isn't any possibility of winning. Everyone's a loser. And isn't this what makes Star Wars so disturbing? The fact that it's being built in the old way of thinking, with the old mentality, that either we can protect ourselves from the enemy or we can win the war through building a new defense and new laser weapon system.
Yeah, I think you're right. I know for myself, when you look at Star Wars, you can see how seductive it is in a way. I mean, we want so much to believe that something would protect us against this horrendous thing that we're up against, and something that would be a quick fix, so to speak, that technology, something in technology could solve this and stop it. And so it's very seductive, in a way, to hope that that would be true. But I agree with you, it's just another level of escalation, really, in the problem of war. Because when you look at it seriously, you say, well, through time, every weapon that we've ever produced has been used, and then another one has been discovered and it's been used, and a lot of them were thought to be the ones that would end war. I mean, the man that discovered the machine gun actually made the statement that only a general who is a barbarian would send his men against such a weapon. And yet we know how it was used in World War I.
It still proved that generals are still barbarians.
Well, I don't know. I don't know if that's the right conclusion. But
but now, Beyond War has produced a little film on the Star Wars, an analysis of it, whether it will work and whether it will not.
Right.
That's very informative. Let's take a look at that.
Okay.
Star Wars is far, far more than is required to protect offensive missiles, but far less than is required to protect people.
Dr. Robert Bowman was the first director of what is now known as the Star Wars program. As an Air Force colonel, his responsibilities included the development of high-energy lasers, advanced surveillance spacecraft, and radar and infrared satellite systems. Following his military career, Dr. Bowman managed the advanced space programs for General Dynamics. He is currently president of the Institute for Space and Security Studies.
I'd like to give you a little briefing on what Star Wars is all about. This first slide indicates the trajectory of an ICBM, starting from its launch point in the Soviet Union through the burn phase or boost phase. There's a post-boost phase when the booster is thrown away and the individual warheads are released. The coast phase or mid-course phase, and then the terminal phase as it re-enters and approaches the target. Now in 1972, we signed the ABM Treaty and we thought that the argument had been closed. What has changed? Why is the debate being reopened? Well, in the late 1960s, we were concentrating on defense in the terminal phase. And that's a very difficult and costly means of defense. all of the proponents of Star Wars systems agree that the big difference in this defense in depth, the key to its success, is the boost phase. In the first place, in the boost phase, you can see your target. The great fiery tail of the booster is visible to our heat-seeking infrared satellites way out in space. Secondly, in the boost phase, the target is more vulnerable. Once you go beyond the boost phase, these individual warheads are relatively small and difficult to hit. They're about this big around. And the third major advantage of boost phase is that there are far fewer targets to begin with. The Soviets now have about 1,400 ICBMs. But each one of those, as it leaves the boost phase, becomes an enormous cloud of targets, perhaps 10 to 20 warheads and several hundred decoys.
Dr. Bowman emphasized that while there are many candidate systems for Star Wars, they all share a common weakness, vulnerability. All of the elements, the targeting mirrors, surveillance satellites, relay mirrors, as well as the weapons themselves, must work perfectly.
Each element of this system has a mass of very advanced complex electronics. They can be wiped out, destroyed, by a nuclear explosion even thousands of miles away. The radiation and electromagnetic pulse will wipe computer chips clean, and once any one critical element is gone, of course, the whole system is useless and becomes $1 trillion worth of junk in space. I've concentrated on vulnerability because, as a military man, I believe that vulnerability is the Achilles heel of a Star Wars system. The Soviets, of course, would know that our defenses were there. They would be able to eliminate them at any time of their choosing, probably just before launching an attack. Now, if the Soviets decide not to blow up our Star Wars systems or use countermeasures so they can go through it, they have yet another alternative, and that's to go around it. If some of you are old enough to remember World War II, you'll remember that Hitler never did go through the Maginot Line. He simply went around it and conquered France in about 2 weeks. A Star Wars system is much like a Maginot Line in the sky. You can go around it. One way to do that is to launch your ballistic missiles from submarines in fairly close to the coast. And then not just the boost phase, but the entire trajectory can lie within the protective blanket of the atmosphere so that it can't be reached by a Star Wars system. And of course, if you put your nuclear weapons on other kinds of delivery systems, like bombers or cruise missiles, whether launched by aircraft or submarines, or any of the other ways of delivering nuclear weapons that stay down low in the atmosphere, Star Wars system can do absolutely nothing about it.
Many critics of Star Wars believe that such systems are not feasible, that the technology is just too complex to overcome. Dr. Bowman disagrees.
Let us assume that all of this can be overcome, that all of the technology becomes available for all five layers of the system. We learn how to do the lasers and the particle beams and the X-rays, the kinetic energy kill vehicles, and all the rest. And that these systems work exactly as designed, perfectly. What would the result be? I am absolutely certain that the best we could hope for would be that we would intercept maybe 10% of the nuclear weapons sent against us. Now, that differs quite a bit from the way the system is advertised. The president did say he was looking to it to make nuclear weapons impotent and obsolete. But what would it take to accomplish the president's objective of doing away with MAD, doing away with the need to threaten retaliation, throwing away our offensive weapons? It would take a system that's not 10%, not 50% like the Pentagon thinks they might be able to do, not 95% like some of the wild dreamers say is possible, not 99.9%, To accomplish that objective, it would have to be 100%. It would have to be perfect. No one thinks that kind of a system can be achieved. The people running the Star Wars system in the Pentagon have no hopes for such a perfect system. They do, however, justify it to Congress by citing another objective which can be achieved by even an imperfect system. And that is to enhance deterrence by protecting our offensive missiles and thereby increasing our ability to retaliate. To enhance deterrence, if that is your objective, you don't need Star Wars. You don't need weapons in space. You don't need to violate the ABM treaty. You don't need to spend $5,000 for every man, woman, and child in the country. And you don't need to put our survival in the hands of computers. The only alternative that allows us to preserve our security and our survival is to make sure that neither side gets a Star Wars system. Our real enemy is not the Soviet Union, but nuclear war itself. And if nuclear war occurs, it will matter little who started it, who is better defended, or who gets in the most blows. The likelihood is that all nations will be destroyed, even those who do not participate. Together we must succeed in ending the arms race, or together we will surely perish.
But the horrors of nuclear war itself would not be the only adverse consequences to ourselves and to our planet. Dr. Carl Sagan talks about the scientific report on nuclear winter, which would be triggered by the explosion of even a few nuclear missiles.
Now, what nuclear winter is about is extremely simple. Fundamentally, what it says is that there will be a large number of fine particles, dust particles, smoke, soot, put into the lower atmosphere and the upper atmosphere that simply blocks the sun. We found that even in comparatively modest nuclear wars, the obscuration of the sun would be very marked. So in, for example, a baseline nuclear war, which involved some 5,000 megatons, which is between a third and a half of the strategic arsenals of the United States and the Soviet Union, the sunlight would drop to a few percent of its ordinary brightness for, we calculate, a period of months. And in our calculations, the temperature drops some 30 to 40 centigrade degrees from ambient. It means the destruction of at least one, perhaps two or more, agricultural crop cycles, unavailability of food, the incapacity of transportation and communication systems, freezing of most water supplies down to a depth of a meter or two. So it means no food, no water, and lots of freezing to death.
I think we're talking about conflict resolution. All these various different things, Star Wars is purportedly a way to resolve conflict, but Beyond War is really emphasizes this and calls for a new way of looking at conflict resolution, doesn't it? Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Well, yes, we're really saying there's two parts to the new way that we have to think, and one of them is that war is obsolete, that it doesn't work anymore. As we said earlier, that there are no winners and no losers. So war does not serve a purpose anymore. And we have to first accept that reality and be very clear about that. And then the second part of the new way of thinking has got to be the reality that we are one family. We have this one beautiful earth to share, and we drink the same water, we breathe the same air, we are all one. on this planet, and there's no place else to go. We either have to learn to live together and to accept our differences and respect the ways of other people, or we will perish together. There's nothing in between right now. Nuclear weapons serve as the equalizer, if you will. They have made all men brothers. And Einstein said that when he watched the atomic explosion. He said, today all men have become brothers.
Robert, Beyond War has what they call three illusions in regard to this. Can you tell us about that?
Well, when we traveled across the country and interviewed people, you could see that people's thinking, and my thinking too, was you could really put the illusions into three categories. One of them is we can continue to war and survive. Most of us walk around, I think, every day believing that war is still a way to do things. So we can continue to war and survive is one big illusion. Another one is they won't let it happen. The president won't let it happen, Congress, the Pentagon, they know what they're doing. We put a lot of trust and faith in our government. So that's a big one. And the last one, and I think the hardest for people to overcome, is I can't do anything about it anyway. It's a huge problem, and what can I as one individual do to change this? And so all of our educational efforts are built around those three illusions and how we can see that war does not work, war is obsolete, and the question is not they won't let it happen, it's more can they keep it from happening because of the possibility of accidents. And you think about Chernobyl and you think about
The Challenger. Right.
Exactly. And you say, can they keep it from happening with 55,000 nuclear weapons all over the globe, computer systems controlling them, you know, the tension between countries. It's more, can they keep it from happening?
Robert, we're going to take a look shortly at a documentary which Beyond War organization has made called Beyond War, New Way of Thinking. And it tells a lot about the organization and how it works. Can you tell us, too, the mode of operation is quite different from so many other peace movements?
Well, there's one key thing that's different, I think, and that is that we are in it for the long haul. We've said to solve this problem long term, we have to change our way of thinking. And you don't make a change like that overnight. It isn't a 1 year or even a 2 year thing. But it is the only lasting solution. And I'm not saying that all the other things that are going on that the peace movement is doing are bad. I think we're all working together toward one end. But we are in it for the long haul and to solve the root cause of war, if you will. And so that's really what we're trying to do.
Your people work more in small groups, in people meeting together and mm-hmm. spreading the word that way rather than, say, being out in the streets or in
right.
demonstrations and all that crap.
It's putting a lot of faith in the individual, and having looked at social changes and how they have occurred in the past, you can see that individuals are key to social changes and to changes in the way people think. If you look at, for example, the women's suffrage movement, you would say that there were many individuals that worked long hours and years to change people's thinking. Education, working to educate people about the need to change their way of thinking. And they worked in living rooms and in organizations and in churches and synagogues, and that's what we're trying to do. We're putting a lot of faith in the individual that if the facts are put before the individual, he or she will make the right choice and do the right thing and respond. So that's primarily what we do. We have presentations in homes and churches and schools and all geared with the idea that we have to change the way we think and that people will then go out and take action. So,
well, let's take a look at that documentary.
Great.
Beyond War.
Beyond War, a new way of thinking. We begin with a startling conclusion, spoken by many of those we talked with, that war, all war, is obsolete. Admiral Jean R. LaRocque, a career naval officer for 31 years, and now director of the Center for Defense Information.
Recently in New York City, I was asked four questions by some children, 10 and 11 years of age. And their questions were simply these. First of all, are we going to have a nuclear war? Secondly, can we win a nuclear war? Thirdly, Can you survive a nuclear war? And fourth, does buying more nuclear weapons make us more secure? Well, my answers, very briefly, first of all, to number one, are we going to have a nuclear war? Yes. All of my military experience and training leads me to believe that we in the Soviet Union are today on a course towards nuclear war.
Time is past when any thinking person could believe that the arms race or the potential destruction of the greater part of all of humanity is not a moral issue. It's certainly not just a technological issue. It's certainly not just a political issue. It is preeminently a moral issue. And it touches on the rights of human beings, it touches on God's rights as the creator, that his creation not be destroyed and desecrated and profaned in this way. So it is preeminently a moral and religious issue.
It means that we have to shake ourselves and start to think in a way that's different from the way in which we've ever thought before.
Dr. Jonas Salk, discoverer of the polio vaccine and founder of the Salk Institute for Biological Studies.
And it is for this reason that I agree that it's in the minds and hearts of men. And it's for that reason that I keep emphasizing the importance of the mind. The mind does not want to be unengaged. It wants to participate in the process of evolution in some constructive way. And if it weren't that way, we wouldn't be sitting here today. But since evolution is an emergent phenomenon, what we have to do, we'll figure out together through this interaction that takes place collectively. Because no one person will necessarily be able to deal with this problem or solve it for all the rest. Therefore, it must mean it must be solved collectively.
The first thing you have to do is to get the public's attention. Something you have to do is you have to somehow or other get an issue which they will then address and realize that it comes home to them as something that they just can't say, well, I'll leave that to somebody else to worry about.
I do think that if we can continue to educate and for local people to really understand how local this problem is, then we will start at this level to make changes, and that those changes will have an impact on the national level, and that that's really the way it's going to happen.
Dr. James Joseph, President of the Council on Foundations and former Undersecretary of the Department of Interior.
And too often individuals are frustrated because they want to begin somewhere else than where they find themselves. And so I think you start as an individual where you are, dealing with whoever it is. If one person changes another person and that person changes another person, then you've got a network going.
I've got to believe that that with a lot of communication, with a lot of discussion, that we can in fact bridge the gap that does exist between the peoples and the cultures of the world. That's what I would like to see. I would like to see a beginning of that.
That's where it is. I think once the people begin to talk to one another, begin to realize that they are really are human beings, that opens a tremendous possibility. Because when the people want it, I think it's going to happen, whether it's in the United States or in the Soviet Union. When the people want it, it will occur.
People really want this to stop. People think we're going in the wrong direction now, very strongly. So I think that's very hopeful.
Public opinion does make a difference. Public attitudes do influence the attitudes of elected and appointed office holders. Public understanding of problems makes a difference.
Now, there's one thing about successful politicians, and that's that they pay attention to their constituents. Otherwise, they don't remain successful, and they don't even remain politicians.
Ann Kahn, director of the Committee for National Security, and formerly with the U.S. Arms Control and Disarmament Agency.
We all belong to a great variety of organizations, whether it's a PTA, or whether it's a religious group, or church, or synagogue. And I think that we need to bring national security, a debate about national security, into our own communities and into our own organizations at all levels. I don't think that there's any group that where it would not be appropriate to have a meeting devoted to discussion about what is national security, can you trust the Russians, who's ahead, whatever the questions are that are bothering people.
Individuals have to recognize that when they come together as groups, they tend to have more power and more influence. And so that the committed individual not only works as an individual, changing other individuals, but becomes part of a larger group or network.
The individual can write to his congressman, can talk to his congressman, can write the letters to the editor, can go to church and talk to the minister or the priest. I think any way is a public communication, because this communication of people is I think, really the finest weapon there ever was. This is democracy.
There's no excuse in this great society of ours not to get what we want. In the United States, the people tell the government what to do. If you want to get a hold of the president, simply pick up the phone, dial the area code for Washington, area code 202, and then dial 456-7639. That's 456-7639, area code 202. And when you call, someone will answer the phone. You say, I'd like to talk to the comment section. I have a comment for the president.
The traditional remedy of participatory democracy is the single best weapon that we have to deal with the nuclear weapons.
Barbara, we've come to the end of this first of a four-part series on war and what we can do about it. Can you give us the local address and phone number for Austin? And because Alternative Views goes to other cities around the country, can you give similar information for the national organization?
Of course.
People are interested.
If you live in Austin, Texas, the number that you would call if you were interested in finding out more about Beyond War or working with Beyond War would be 345-4698. And then if you live in other parts of the country, there is a national office in Palo Alto, California, and the phone number there is 415-328-7756.
Okay. Well, that brings this first portion of this four-part series to a conclusion. Next week, we're going to look at wars other than nuclear. Groups just talk about nuclear war. Of course, that's the big one. But we also have conventional wars, which are extremely destructive, as World War II and Vietnam have indicated. But we also have low-intensity warfare now, which is a new doctrine, which is more covert and causes horrible, horrible suffering, particularly in the Third World. We'll look at this type of conflict on the next program. Good night.
And that's Alternative Views for this time. We have a lot of people to thank: our director, David Galasich, camera people, Judy Burton, Kelly Maddox, and Brian Lynch, our audio man, Richard Jones, and our editor, Linda Borgeson. We also would like to thank Austin Community Television, ACTV, for the use of their equipment. Alternative Views is a presentation of the Alternative Information Network, P.O. Box 7279, Austin, Texas, 78713. If you have any questions or comments about this or any program of Alternative Views, please let us know. There's our address. We'd be glad to hear from you.
This is CUNY TV, the City University of New York.
We are group creatures, and all group creatures, from ants all the way up to men, are programmed to distrust outgroupers. And when two groups get into conflict, either about goals they both want and only one can achieve, or about values that are incompatible, then that mutual distrust rapidly escalates into what's been called the image of the enemy, where gradually the enemy becomes all bad and we become all good.
And we're the good guys and they're the bad guys. They are the foreign other. They're trying to move in. So all forms of communism movements get seen in that light.
Cannot achieve anything by, you know, making us spend more and more on military powers.
I mean, it's just
except creating, you know, more tensions, more problems for us. And, you know, by the way, problems in each country are very risky because they can very easily be transformed into militarism, you know, some kind of scapegoat, you know, finding and so on. So I really hope that United States will solve its own problems, will get much more peace-oriented, much more relaxed in this sense. Well, the same goes for my own country.
The Soviets are not our enemy, our people are not our enemy, that today, with nuclear weapons, the weapons themselves have become our enemy. And that is the way we're going to have to learn to think and to recognize that as the reality today, because we share this globe with all people. And nuclear weapons have made us all brothers and connected us all together, because if we ever use nuclear weapons, we will all die, not just our enemies.
There's very much we'd like to say to America, only we don't believe it will reach them. I wish we could talk together as I'm talking to you right now, simply and as friends. I was a participant in the war. I know what war is. If my words would reach your people, then I'd be happy. That they understand me. All mothers will understand. Please, I really ask you, make peace with us.
Does the United States need enemies? Does it have enemies? Who are the enemies? How is the image of the enemy used in the United States? This is the emphasis on the third of our four-part series on war. Right now on Alternative Views. This is the third in our four-part series on war. First one was on nuclear war, various ramifications of that. We saw some wonderful documentaries provided to us by the Beyond War people. The second program is about conventional war and low-intensity warfare. And tonight we're going to focus in on a smaller subject, but a very basic one, that is the enemy. Why are we always posing enemies? Do we need enemies, or are there really enemies out there that we have to be aware of? Or do we create our own enemies? Or if the Soviets are our enemies, well, can we really trust them to try to come to any agreement and reduce the chances of war? We still have Barbara Carlson with us. She's with the Beyond War movement. And Barbara, this is one of the very interesting aspects of Beyond War, that you do make quite an analysis of the enemy.
Mm-hmm. Well, we've actually said that the Soviets are not our enemy, our people are not our enemy, that today, with nuclear weapons, the weapons themselves have become our enemy. And that is the way we're going to have to learn to think and to recognize that as the reality today. Because we share this globe with all people, and nuclear weapons have made us all brothers and connected us all together, because if we ever use nuclear weapons, we will all die, not just our enemies. So they have been a very big equalizer for people.
There seems to be a big preoccupation with the enemy, mm-hmm. whether it's Soviets or communism or terrorists or leftists or whatever. Always focusing on somebody or an organization or a group of people or a nation mm-hmm. or an ideology, whatever, as the enemy mm-hmm. rather than trying to live and adjust and cohabit with it. Mm-hmm. Beyond War has a presentation by a professor, is it not?
Yes, it's Dr. Jerome Frank is his name, Jerome Frank, and he's from John Hopkins University. And he does a piece called The Image of the Enemy that is excellent, that talks about it and makes some very good statements.
Good, let's take a look.
Dr. Jerome Frank is Professor Emeritus of Psychiatry at the Johns Hopkins School of Medicine in Baltimore. He was with the Medical Corps in the Pacific when the bombs were dropped on Hiroshima and Nagasaki. His conclusion then, as now, was that the price of civilization was the elimination of nuclear weapons and war itself. Dr. Frank talked to us about the psychological causes of war, about being human, and being violent.
Violence is different from almost all other drives. We have to eat, we have to drink, we have to sleep, we have to breathe. We don't have to be violent. People can go through life, well, like Gandhi, let's say, and be perfectly healthy, robustly healthy, without ever being violent. So we don't have to, that's the hopeful thought. We don't have to exercise this aspect of ourselves. It's a pitfall to say that because of a biological trait, the social institution can't be eliminated. That because we're violent, we have to have war. It's like saying because we're meat eaters, we have to have cannibalism.
What is it that separates and alienates us, that continues to broaden the gap between understanding and cooperation?
We are group creatures, and all group creatures, from ants all the way up to men, are programmed to distrust outgroupers. And when two groups get into conflict, either about goals they both want and only one can achieve, or about values that are incompatible, then that mutual distrust rapidly escalates into what's been called the image of the enemy, where gradually the enemy becomes all bad and we become all good. There's been a striking example recently of the all good aspect of the United States with respect to Russia, and that is when General Vesey, the chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, said, the Russians know we're not going to attack them anyway. This in spite of the fact that we have invaded Russia once and that our official policy is to be prepared to attack Russia with nuclear weapons. I can't give you the reference, actually. But since we know we're good, they must know that we're not really going to attack them. And that, you see, then means, well, since they really know we're not going to attack them, their buildup, which they say is defensive, must really be aggressive.
This all-good, all-bad view of one another, Dr. Frank calls the mirror image.
The mirror image filters out information that would not confirm it and overemphasizes information that would confirm it. So each side notes all the things that happen that confirm their evil image of the other side. I was struck by a very simple one the other day. I suddenly saw a picture of Khrushchev smiling. When do we see pictures of Russian leaders smiling? And they're politicians like everybody else. They kiss babies and they do all the things that our politicians do, but they're always dour and tough, you know. And I'm sure they select pictures that show the same for us. That's the kind of filter I mean. The conciliatory moves are interpreted either as ruses to cause us to drop our guard, us being both sides now, or we just don't notice them and we focus on the hostile moves. The image of the enemy also is a self-fulfilling prophecy. That's the terribly dangerous thing about it. In order to counteract what we perceive as the evil of the enemy, the treachery and cruelty, which can be documented, we become treacherous and cruel ourselves, so that both sides then really are enemies. And that's the box that the world gets into, that nations have gotten into over and over again in history.
And when the possibility of dialogue and the exchange of ideas does occur, fear of compromise quickly slams the door.
And the image of the enemy ruptures communication. You see, because you don't trust the enemy, and therefore, if you let him communicate with you, he might convince you or he might, of his viewpoint, or he might get information about you that he could use to your disadvantage. So the temptation is always to stop communicating, as we have seen right after the Korean airliner disaster. We broke off cultural communications. It also, I guess, has the component of to punish the other guy. Like you send the child to stand on the corner. It seems to be that kind of philosophy.
Dr. Frank added, as the image of the enemy intensifies, the options for solutions diminish.
The image of the enemy implies that all conflicts are zero-sum games. That is, we're both, there's a winner and a loser always. It overlooks the increasing number of conflicts which are variable-sum games. Both, they have solutions in which both sides win and solutions in which both sides lose. And right now, for example, the nuclear-free, a verifiable mutual nuclear freeze would be a win-win solution. Continuing arms race is a lose-lose solution. But we lose sight of that because we're always thinking at every moment in terms of win-lose solutions. In the past, somebody always won the war, and even the loser usually survived. That is what has changed. Now, if the nuclear catastrophe happens, neither side can possibly win, and both may not survive.
Then what is the use of war? Dr. Frank looked at history and politics and the end of an institution.
There's no political goal that can be conceived, can be achieved by a nuclear war. Furthermore, the evidence that war is already dying out is that no war since World War II, if you stop to think about it, that could have involved the nuclear powers has been fought to a victory. The Arab-Jewish wars and over in that area, and all over the world there have been wars. Even the Falklands War is not settled. The only war in which one side won was the Vietnam War, in which the weaker non-nuclear power prevailed. And that's a very interesting question. It certainly shows that war doesn't work. Obviously, that was the choice of the United States. They would prefer to be defeated than to use nuclear weapons. I'm not enough of a political scientist to know why they reached that decision. But just the fact that they reached it seems to me is very strong evidence that the war is becoming an ineffective way of resolving problems. But social institutions disappear, often with great agony, I must say, and over a long period of time, when they stop fulfilling the purpose for which they were created. And that is what's happening to war now. When hostile groups find that they have to cooperate in order to survive, this has been called a superordinate goal. And the world is full of the necessity and the incentives now for cooperation towards such goals. For example, the control of pollution. No nation alone can control pollution. If we don't kill ourselves with a nuclear war, we're going to kill ourselves by destroying the environment if we don't get together on it. That's one example. The International Geophysical Year is one that's actually working. All the nations of the world wanted information about the ocean bottoms and about the land masses, and they couldn't get it alone. So with great difficulty, they agreed to demilitarize the Antarctic, and they decided to only risk it for 18 months and just get to work. And it worked so beautifully that they're now operating on a 30-year treaty. And of course, one I'm proud of here at Hopkins is the elimination of smallpox. That was a worldwide effort under the World Health Organization, run by our dean over here at the School of Hygiene. These new possibilities exist that never existed before. They're not only possibilities, as I say, they're necessities. And to me, that's the most hopeful thing, because these experiments show that if people keep on cooperating, their mutual fear, well, they have new experiences all the time of the success of cooperation. That, to me, is the basic reason why we have to change our ways of thinking about each other.
Dr. Frank continues to teach at Johns Hopkins and is lecturing throughout the country on the need to reduce nuclear arms.
The Soviet Union and America are not friends because the Soviet Union does not want a war and America does. The U.S. wants to conquer the rest of the world.
Who there wants a war?
Reagan. Reagan. And his administration.
Why?
They don't like that everyone be equal on Earth. They want to take power over the rest of the world. They want to make other countries bow down to them.
What do you think will happen?
I think there will be no war, because the Soviet Union is doing everything to prevent one.
You know, recently I was covering a conference in Washington of lawyers from both countries. Soviet delegation came and they met American lawyers. They had rather productive discussions. They published joint paper saying that peaceful coexistence is something absolute necessity nowadays. And then there was a reception, and one gentleman, he is a prominent lawyer from Harvard, he told me, I have a feeling that if they let us stay in the same house for months at least, we will settle all our problems. We will not change our ways of life, but most outstanding problems we can change. Maybe he exaggerates opportunities of lawyers, but in general, this is a good approach. We must increase our exchanges. We must know each other better. This will help, I think, the governments also to come to an agreement. I want to tell you frankly and honestly that not a single Russian citizen, Soviet citizen, is thinking about war against the United States in terms of winning this country, in terms of spreading communism. This is a lie which is very often repeated by right-wing groups. We want peaceful coexistence with this country. We respect this country very much. American literature is thought to be the greatest, maybe, literature of the 20th century, and so many books are translated into Russian. We want to know this country more, and we want to have peaceful relations with you.
Why does the United States have so many giant arms pointed at us?
They say for defense.
Only the Soviet Union has arms for defense. Only the Soviet Union has arms for defending ourselves from outsiders. Only the Soviet Union has agreed never to be the first to use nuclear weapons. But the United States won't agree to this. Why don't they sign such a peaceful agreement?
There was quite recently a suggestion that we would sit and discuss the problem of the theater nuclear war. Mm-hmm. And we are ready to reduce our middle-range missiles in Europe if NATO will not go for this Pershing II and Trident program, mm-hmm. a new program. So I think this is a good thing. And there was also the suggestion of a moratorium, or a freeze.
Freeze.
Yes, freeze immediately followed by negotiating both strategic armaments and theater nuclear armaments, which, by the way, psychologically for a lot of Russians are also strategic, because middle-range missiles in Europe, American, for example, they can reach Soviet Union.
Right.
Our middle-range missiles cannot reach the United States. But, you know, this definition we can let strategists and military experts, you know, deal with. What are strategic, what is the theater nuclear missile? The main thing is to reduce all of them as soon as possible. And in this, for this, we must build up trust, you know, step by step. I meet sometimes people who just demand immediate and absolute reduction, which I think is impractical. We must go step by step, building up trust. More trust we have, better we go in this direction.
Would Europe be a good place to begin? This has been historically the center of the most catastrophic wars. And it seems now there's a debate about whether American nuclear weapons should be placed in Europe. And Europe is worried also, some countries, about Soviet medium-range missiles that are aimed at Europe. Would it be possible to make Europe a nuclear-free missile zone as a beginning that wouldn't even necessarily depend on American negotiation if the Europeans decided they wouldn't have any missiles there and if the Soviets would take away all missiles aimed at Europe? Is there any movement towards this kind of negotiation?
Yes, I think so, because I think there is a movement to turn the Northern Europe, for example, Baltic states and Scandinavian countries into a nuclear-free zone. Then there was a suggestion on our part to turn Mediterranean area to be nuclear-free. But you must understand that you cannot absolutely forget about American forces, about the bases of American missiles, you know, and aircraft carriers, which are in Europe. So it's not only the problem of Europe and the Soviet Union, it's the problem of NATO, very often, and Warsaw Pact as well. So we must go in all direction, actually.
The American economy, as you noted earlier, is suffering a recession, and Reagan himself is calling for budget spends and budget cuts and reducing government spending. One of the greatest of our foreign outputs of the money that we spend that gives us a bad balance of payment is maintaining all those troops.
Well, yes.
In Europe, and we're trying to get NATO and the European countries to pay for them, and they're not willing to have much of the expenses. It seems to me it would be a great shot in the arm of the American economy to take the American troops out of Europe. Do you think the Europeans would allow this, though? Or is there still some fear or tensions between the European countries and the Soviet Union?
Well, of course, there are tensions. We must go, you know, step by step in creating trust. There are tensions on our part as well on the European part. But I think there are some good indications that we can see it. There is also peace movement, as you know, in Europe very much. Of course, there is apprehension. For example, you speak about American bases in Europe, but, you know, they are not only in Europe. There's about 1,500 bases all over the world, you know, all over the Soviet Union as well, with about 500,000 of people. As to the economic problems, I do believe that conversion can be made, and it can be good for both countries.
To convert not from a defense
exactly, to a from military
economy.
Purposes to welfare economy to the industrialization, reindustrialization, and so on. Human growth, so to say, solving ecological and energy problems. Because I've met some American economists who just proved to me, I don't know, I'm not an economist, that it will be more profitable for the United States to have a, so to say, peaceful-oriented economy, because it would create more jobs. Military economy doesn't produce a lot of jobs.
The same with the Soviet Union.
With the
The Soviets spend, I understand, a higher percentage of their gross national product on armaments than the United States.
Yes,
but it
course,
is a
because
smaller...
the productivity is lower.
Right.
So if the productivity is lower for the same amount of equipment, you, so to say, you use much more power, much more resources.
So it would be even better for the Soviet Union to reduce their expenditures.
Definitely.
Do you think there's this, a kind of another strategic type of thing in that the U.S. the people who run the U.S. government feel that if they can keep the expenditures high in the United States for arms, it will force the Soviets to do the same thing. And because of that, the Soviets will have less money to spend to support Cuba or Nicaragua or other places around the country.
Or their own country for that.
Or even their own country and raise the standard of living and therefore create a happier economy among the even the Russians.
I'm not aware of any kind of intentional stratagems like this.
I mean, it seems
but,
logical or possible.
Logically, it seems also rather impractical because we have proved already, you know, our country that it can go on by building military power, you know, in spite of the lower productivity or a lot of problems in agriculture. So actually, it can be done. You cannot achieve anything by, you know, making us spend more and more on military powers.
I mean, it's just
except creating, you know, more tensions, more problems for us. And you know, by the way, problems in each country are very risky because they can very easily be transformed into militarism. You know, some kind of scapegoat, you know, finding and so on. So I really hope that United States will solve its own problems, will get much more peace-oriented, much more relaxed in this sense. Well, the same goes for my own country.
We've learned a lot about enemies in psychology in the last 20, 25 years, about how human beings, it's a normal and natural thing to, rather than face something about yourself that you don't like, you project it out on somebody else so that you don't have to look at it in yourself. Mm-hmm. And we haven't always known that. I mean, that's a new understanding about ourselves as humans. And so you can see how that works You can see how it works between nations, and you can see how it works in relationships within families and
groups. Yeah, I used to know a guy who said he always knew what his wife was up to by what she accused him of doing.
Right.
Maybe that's it. Well, let's talk about the Russians, since they're supposedly the bad guys. You made a trip to the Soviet Union. Can you tell us your impression?
Well, I went with my husband and our three teenage children last year, and we were there about 2 weeks. And the thing I came away feeling, well, really two things. Number one, they do think very differently than we do. There is no doubt about that, that in some ways they are not like us. In many ways, they are not like us. But they also, in some ways, are very much like us. They want to live. They care about their children. They do not want war. They have suffered incredibly in war. I realize that I don't know anything about war compared to them. The guide that we had in the Soviet Union was a 22-year-old woman that had just graduated from the University of Leningrad. And we asked her if we could go out to the cemetery outside Leningrad, where there are 500,000 civilians buried that died in the siege of Leningrad. Most of them starved to death. And her grandparents are buried there, and many, many other relatives. And you just realize also, as you look around on the streets, that there are no men between the ages of 50 and 60. There's an absence of men that age, because they all died in World War II. 22 million people is a conservative number that died in the Soviet Union. And so they have a very real experience with war and have suffered greatly, and certainly do not want war. Every place we went, people would come up to us and say, when they knew we were from America, from the United States, and they would say, we do not want war.
You know, that's what I've talked to so many people who've traveled in the Soviet Union, and they all say that.
That was my experience. And did you meet with peace groups in the Soviet Union that indicated a sincere interest in peace and better relations with the U.S.?
We didn't do that. We went really not with a group, so we didn't meet with anyone officially, but we did have a very nice experience on a train one evening. We were in a train car going from Leningrad to Novgorod. And we developed a relationship with many people in the train, and there was a communist family sitting behind us. And it was an interesting thing for us to realize that only 7% of the people in the Soviet Union are communists. I somehow had the idea that, you know, more people than that were communists, but only 7%. But this man was a communist and had been a communist member for a long time. And we had a really nice conversation with he and his family, and he asked us, we asked him what the biggest problem was in his country right now. And he said, the nuclear arms race is taking things away from our people that they need. And then he asked us what the biggest problem was, and we said, the nuclear arms race is taking things away from people here that are needed too. And so you could see that we're very different in many ways, but we're also very much alike, and none of us want to have war. I mean, we do want to live.
We've done interviews or recorded a speech by Helen Caldicott, a peace activist. She talked about whether we can trust the Russians when it comes to any type of agreement.
What I'm really telling you is that war is obsolete. I mean, didn't Einstein say it? He said the splitting of the atom changed everything save man's mode of thinking. Thus we drift towards unparalleled catastrophe. And I stress the man's mode of thinking. Because in Honduras, those Marines have probably got tactical nuclear weapons, and I hope to God the Russians have enough sense not to get involved, but if they do, there's the seeds of a thermonuclear holocaust right there. And we assume a tremendous amount of sanity on the part of the Soviet leaders, don't we? I mean, we push them and rough them around, and what we're really saying is, go on, press the button, go on, because people say, we don't trust the Russians. Like hell we don't trust them. We trust them every second of our lives. We're sitting here per favor of the Russian leaders. Right? Because our destiny lies not in our hands, it lies in their hands. They decide every second whether we live or die. I mean, really, they're our best friends on the face of the earth. And if you're going to have a heart transplant tomorrow and your cardiac surgeon comes in tonight, you don't tell him he's an evil surgeon. Because he's going to be holding your heart in his hand tomorrow. Well, the Russians hold our heart in their hand. True? And America set up her own suicide by leading the arms race, and they stupidly have copied and followed. They're crazy just like we are. All crazy men wanting to prove how big their things are or something. What about the Russians? Okay, let me tell you what about the Russians. We know how the Russian leaders feel at the moment because we work with their physicians, especially the guy who has treated Andropov, Brezhnev, and now Chernenko. He's got a bad track record. He's a cardiologist. His name is Chazov, and he's in the presidium, and we work very closely with him. I tell you, the Russian leaders are absolutely desperate. I told you about the 14 treaties that were being negotiated. I told you they're ready right now to sign the complete test ban treaty. Bill told you they have put a unilateral moratorium on testing of anti-satellite weapons pending a negotiation to ban them altogether. In 1979, before the crews and Pershing 2s went into Europe, they said, Brezhnev said, we will remove 10,000 troops and 10,000 troops and 1,000 tanks from East Germany if you'll sit down and talk to us about not deploying the crews and Pershing 2s. That offer was totally ignored. He still did it. He said, we will stop deploying any more SS-20s. Finish if you sit down and talk to us. That offer was totally ignored. They have made unilateral moves. Not big enough, I agree. What I'm saying is that none of us are perfect, and we've all done bad things. And what did Jesus say, that great psychiatrist who lived 2,000 years ago? He said, I have no enemy, for he is myself. It means that nobody can make you feel bad. You decide to feel bad yourself. Now, you can all think of somebody in your life you really can't stand or might even hate. All they do, we walk around with big red buttons on our tummy, and they press our button, and we don't like them. And we feel bad or angry or jealous or hate them. But all they've done is trigger our own feelings, and we decide whether or not to hate or project our feelings outwards. And what Jesus was meaning was, in order to grow up and mature and become adults, we have to stop blaming other people for our own bad feelings and take responsibility. And that means we have to go and sit down with the Russians and say, we've done bad things too, true? And so have you. Let's talk and get to understand each other so we don't blow up the world. Would Jesus do that? Would he? Would he have done that? You know very well he would have. Well, Jesus did die, and on the cross Jesus said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. In the Lord's Prayer it says, forgive our trespasses as we forgive them that trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. And we are about to commit the most atrocious evil that has ever occurred on earth. That is destroying the creation. And we're doing it, you and I, by remaining passive.
Now, we've had John Stockwell on, former CIA official, several many times on the program. His book, his first book, was called In Search of Enemies. Mm-hmm. He has some interesting observations in this regard.
You've got to remember, and this is why I titled my book In Search of Enemies, it's necessary to our system of government to have people to oppose and people to hate. If you'll look, for example, I believe it was yesterday, President Carter just finished a small political swing. He made repeated statements about Cuba, Cuba's aggressive posture, Cuba being the most militarized country in the world, etc. Surely we have things that are more important than Cuba to this nation right now. The collapsing economy, the galloping inflation, all of the various minority groups that are still suffering persecution in this country. He nevertheless, he focuses on Cuba and makes them into an enemy which they have no desire to be, so that we've got somebody to hate, to oppose, so that we've got an excuse to thump our chest and build up our military machine. And he's doing this, obviously, as a major element in his presidential campaign, searching for enemies, looking for people that don't want to fight us, that we need to have somebody to oppose.
Nicaragua makes me alternately want to cry and want to scream. It's kind of brought me back out of retirement on the lecturing and speaking out, because I'd very much been working to get into writing novels and building a fiction writing career. Once again, the United States government has designated a small country with a people's-oriented government as threatening to our national security interests. And as the Nicaraguan ambassador said in the United Nations Security Council yesterday, the United States is waging war against Nicaragua, undeclared war, but it's war. And Kirkpatrick got up enraged and waved her arms and stomped out. Because her position is simply totally untenable. She could not sit there and face the world, because we are waging war today against Nicaragua. We're killing Nicaraguans by the dozens, by the droves. We're arming Contras, which is one of the fact, the Somocists who were thrown out. We're arming them. We're equipping them with mercenaries from other countries, training them, working through and with the Honduran army, and sending them in waves. Now the second wave of over 1,300 people went in just last week. Attacking and killing. We're not killing communists. The Communist Party does not support the Sandinistas. They don't believe in what the Sandinistas believe in. They're not killing Russians. They're not killing KGB. They're not killing Cubans, God forbid. I hope they never do kill Cubans. They're just killing people that happen to have the misfortune of being born in northern Nicaragua. We've done this in Angola, Vietnam. We've done it over 20,000 times in the last 35 years. The point is that the so-called radical governments, what's radical? The ones that believe in people-oriented societies, that does not mean that they're our enemies economically or otherwise, unless we attack them. They're believing, the Angolans believe in exactly what this country believed in when we had our own revolution. And so do the Nicaraguans. We threw out George V and the British. They threw out Somoza. Bloodthirsty, oppressive killers, corrupt, enriching themselves off the country. All this country has to do is get its ideology straight and say, hey, you know, a national holiday declared because the Nicaraguan people succeeded in rising up and ousting a corrupt dictator who was stealing money and disrupting commerce. Now they're happier and we'll make more money and everybody will be happier. Instead, we declare war on them. We consider it a defeat. But not we, the American people. It's not a defeat to the values we believe in. It's a defeat for the CIA, because they helped put Somoza in power and sustain them in power. It's a defeat for the CIA, but not for this country. It shouldn't be.
The CIA and the FBI need to have terrorists in the world to justify their increased money for appropriations. For instance, when the CIA made their latest report, they indicated that there were 3,336 terrorist attacks during the previous year. Now, Alexander Haig didn't think that was enough, so he sent the report back to the CIA, say, give me more terrorist attacks, so they upped it to almost 6,000.
The only answer is that a little bit of both, that you have an organization that functions in a troubled world. It gets more money and more opportunity, as like you say, Haig wants 6,000 terrorist bombings last year, not 3,000, because it's more dramatic and he can get more mileage out of it. The CIA, by the same token, would like to have a more troubled world, because they have more to do. The president and the Congress and the press and everybody are relying on them and giving them their carte blanche more in a troubled world than in a peaceful world.
This is my thesis exactly, In Search of Enemies. The CIA's function, as I see it, is to destabilize the world and keep it hostile. You can't perform in our, with our economy without having hostility and conflict. Just one simple little illustration, and of course it's a very complex subject, but we are planning $2 trillion to be spent on defense in the next next 5 years. And yet our cities are falling apart. New York City, for example, Washington, bridges are collapsing, sewage systems are not working, our education system has plummeted to eighth in the world and is going down. I was in Budapest in May, and that city is beautiful by comparison with New York or Washington or Detroit, for example, or Houston, in terms of repair, in terms of cleanliness. How can you keep the people in line and content with such an expenditure on arms when you're not taking care of them and the places they live, unless the world is just terribly threatening? And the CIA's function is to keep the world threatening. That's my analysis.
Well, I think we've definitely got to move to stabilize the economic situation.
Couldn't agree more, Bob.
We've got to let these people know we mean business.
Exactly. Excuse me. You know, it's incredible the way those minerals are just lying there.
We're definitely going to have to bring in some heavy equipment.
Look! Oil! Very good, Ted. Thanks.
Of course, we're going to have to protect it.
What are you doing? This is my country.
Don't worry about it. Is this the guy we're backing?
I think that's the one, remember? Excuse me. This is a private meeting. Would you mind? Yeah, I think that's the guy who was back last year.
Why is the church so concerned about persons on the other edge of the world? Because they're still getting etched out.
Sociologist Bill Gibson wrote a book on the Vietnam War called The Perfect War. He analyzes for us the attitudes of the Americans in relationship to the enemy, the communists.
Why Vietnam? Americans saw communism not as another type of social organization, as another culture, as another political system, but instead they saw Americans as the good, the natural, the godlike, and the communism was a foreign other, an alien kind of being. The world was divided into simply two types of people, communist and non-communist, and therefore it was like debit or credit, their side or our side. By the time the Vietnamese overthrew the French in the late 50s, we had our theory of limited war intact, we had our conventional forces ready to go by the late 50s. Vietnam was simply a convenient mode, place to test out this new theory of warfare, techno-war, and a place to drive the foreign other back. The United States has been unwilling to deal with communism as a political, social, and economic movement. Instead, it gets seen that we as Americans are the natural beings of the world, and that capitalism is the natural economic order, and that our system is simply the essence of human goodness and the essence of nature. Therefore, something very, very different from us is not another society with whom one compares differences and makes treaties with and so on and so forth, but instead is an alien presence. If we're nature, they're anti-nature, or what I call the foreign other. During World War II, the Soviet Union did take over, right after World War II, did invade and take over Eastern Europe, the Red Army did, and you had to hold it as a buffer zone, and they did install puppet dictatorships there. This became the model for all American views of communist and socialist of any kind. Americans did not understand internal revolution. They did not understand the Chinese Revolution in the 40s, that there were like millions upon millions of poor peasants who wanted land to survive, and that Mao Zedong and the Communist Party offered them land and survival, whereas Chiang Kai-shek was a warlord who offered them nothing. So, unable to see internal struggles for socialism or communism, or unable to see even internal struggles for national independence against colonialism, right, the world gets divided into them and us. Mm-hmm. And we're the good guys and they're the bad guys. They are the foreign other. They're trying to move in. So all forms of communism movements get seen in that light. So in this sense, then, any particular movement in the world is not just a particular movement in a dirt-poor country. And let's remember how dirt-poor Vietnam is then. and we had very little investment there. Instead, any movement is a sign of the global movement.
A victory, by the Soviet Union.
A few poor peasants win in Vietnam, that doesn't mean just that they have, that a little few more people have a few more rights. Instead, that means that the foreign other, the monolithic machine, has encroached one more step, and that with each other step, the rest of the world becomes in peril. This, of course, is the domino theory. So like a contagious disease, sort of, instead of like each country having its own history and its own culture and its own people, it's as if the world is an empty shell, like a chessboard, and it's either our side or their side, and once they get going, just somehow a mechanistic momentum will propel communism to victory. It's a very, I call it mechanistic anti-communism, because it's a mechanistic framework of the world, and the enemy is foreign other. They aren't any real enemy at all. It's an abstraction. Most haven't learned a thing. There are veterans, of course, in the U.S. who certainly don't want to see this. There are probably parts of the military in very subordinate positions who don't want to see a major escalation. But generally, we're on track for another kind of major intervention, whether or not it will be, since the Iran-Agua crisis has emerged, that may be off for a while. I don't know. But there's certainly Philippines. There's another growing insurgency there. The chances for another major intervention and another series of self-delusions are very, very high, because the people, the officer corps who were successful in Vietnam are the people who are in charge now. The people who were the dissidents, the few handfuls of lieutenant colonels and majors who just got repulsed, they got out. They resigned. Most of them did. And then the final reason I note the problem of learning is that there are cultural reasons that make the American people want to believe the self-imposed restraint school. And that is, we are used to the tradition of the cowboy who comes in and saves the society against the enemies when the power structure cannot defend itself. The idea of a weak authority that has to be saved by a warrior shows up in many places in American culture. In the Western, in the detective hero is outside the law. All the Superman and the masked Avenger figures of the 20s and 30s certainly are able to foil criminals that legal authorities cannot.
But also, isn't there a deep belief that technology cannot fail
certainly
in American culture, that if we have enough technological or military force, we can't help but win a war?
It's hard not to believe in your hardware. Americans don't learn about social relations. They don't learn about class structure every day in the newspaper, or about cultural history every day in the newspaper. They learn about what's for sale.
Then what is the lesson of Vietnam concerning the limits of techno-war, the situations in which
techno-war can destroy, but it cannot achieve victory. Mm. It can destroy land, it can destroy people, but it can't create a government, it can't create a culture, it can't create a society.
Former Senator William Fulbright expressed it this way: if we insist on viewing the Soviets as total incorrigible enemies, that is the way we shall have them, for that view allows for nothing else, and down that road we will find catastrophe.
There have been a lot of contacts and a lot of cooperation between American scientists and Soviet scientists, have there not?
Yes, there has been. Not just scientists. We've officially made a number of trips to the Soviet Union. The 1984 Beyond War Award to the International Positions for the Prevention of Nuclear War was done in a satellite hookup between Moscow and San Francisco, the first satellite hookup that had occurred between those two cities. And that was very positive, to be able to work with them on something so uplifting and so positive. And so we began to develop a relationship out of that experience. And then since then, different citizens groups from Beyond War individuals have gone. But also there is a group of scientists headed up by Dr. Martin Hellman from Stanford that are working with scientists in the Soviet Union to try to prepare a joint statement that would talk about the inevitability of nuclear war. That if we do not change, war is going to happen, and that we do not want that. So they are working on that now and working together to try to make that come about, and it will be a powerful statement from scientists from both countries.
Well, thank you. Well, that's all the time for our third program on our four-part series on alternative views on war and what we can do to help prevent it. Next week, we'll emphasize more on what we can do, the positive aspects of it, and we'll see some things of which we'll really, really touch you deeply and inspire you, so be sure to join us then.
Meanwhile, we have time for three news stories from alternative sources.
There are a couple of reports concerning the Star Wars program of Reagan, or as he likes to call it, the SDI. One is from the American Physical Society, and the other one comes from a Proxmire committee in the Senate. And they say, come to independent conclusions, that the effective space-based defense system still resides principally in the realm of wishful thinking. And the studies indicate that the administration's early deployment scheme is not advisable, to put it lightly. The Senate report was based upon interviews with 60 scientists who are all working on the SDI program. And they say that the thing probably will never work, even though they could spend billions of dollars on it, and it's highly problematic whether it would work at all. And even now, with which the scientists were saying, they'd say even as early as 1994, at the cost of tens of billions of dollars, still they couldn't come up with a system that would be any more than 16% effective. That's a lot of missiles coming in that aren't being touched by Star Wars. But the Pentagon and the State Department all have said, well, they've told Congress, that's okay, we're just doing research, we're really not going to do any deployment on it. However, it seems that the Pentagon officials covertly are getting contractors' proposals, they're soliciting these, so that they can do just that, go on to early deployment.
On May the 14th, there was a military coup d'etat in the Fiji Islands in the South Pacific, and you might have seen pictures of this on American TV for the next couple days, that presented this coup d'etat as an ethnic quarrel between natives of the Fiji Islands and the Indians who had colonized from India that island and were involved in something of an ethnic series of quarrels and political quarrels for some time. You get some different background material on the Fiji Islands in The Guardian and The Nation of this month that indicates that there might have been a CIA plot involved in overthrowing the new democratically elected government in the Fiji Islands. The new government that just won the election of Krishna Dutt had proposed joining New Zealand and Australia, or rather New Zealand and Vanuatu, in pressing for a nuclear-free South Pacific zone. You recall that New Zealand passed some laws indicating that there would be no nuclear weapons in New Zealand or no nuclear submarines that could dock there. And the new government of the Fiji Islands wanted to do the same. And Dutt also said that he was in favor of trade and technical agreements with the Soviet Union. And it's precisely this government that was overthrown for the military government that was involved in all kinds of anti-Soviet rhetoric when they took over. The reason that there's suspicion that there might have been CIA involvement in this was because the Reagan administration has consistently done everything possible to make sure that no governments in the South Pacific or anywhere else in the world set up nuclear-free zones. Moreover, General Vernon Walters, who's a notorious CIA coup maker, was present in the Fijis a few weeks before the takeover. And a couple days before the takeover, members of the new government security force said they saw five Americans in the duty-free area of the airport in the Fiji Islands meeting with the military leader, who was later the head of the coup. The press in Australia and New Zealand has reported that there's substantial evidence of outside involvement in the coup, and pointed out that immediately after losing the election, the previous head of government went to Honolulu for a couple weeks, where he met with U.S. officials, including the U.S. Commander-in-Chief of the Pacific Command, and met with the American Embassy officials there. So there may have been quite a bit of conspiracy going on between the former Fiji government, the military, the CIA, and the U.S. Military that might have been behind that coup in this formerly peaceful island, that I think it ended something like 17 years of democratic rule.
Here is something which stunned me as a former naval officer, naval reservist, to see that a very basic change has been made in the rights of the reservists. Now, in the past, if when a reservist goes on his 2 weeks training, well, he or she is subject to the regular uniform code of military justice. And also on the weekend of drills or the one night a week when they drill, they are also subject to the military code of justice. But things are changing now because the fact that a reservist may be released from duty after a drill weekend or a two-week active duty training period or whatever no longer excludes him or her from military jurisdiction. A reservist is now subject to disciplinary action, military disciplinary action, throughout the enlistment. And heck, that may be 10, 15, 20 years. Congress has also authorized, with limitations, the involuntary recall of reservists to active duty for disciplinary action. That's incredible to think that these people are now going to be subject to military law no matter where they go at any time, even though they're not even directly under the control of the military at that particular time. And there are all kinds of things, for instance, that there's that general law 134 of the Uniform Code of Military Justice, in which you can be court-martialed for behavior which is, quote, unbecoming a member of the armed service.
Hmm.
And there are also all kinds of sexual things. You can't have oral sex. You can't be an adulterer. So if Jim Baker had been been in the reserves, he'd been in bad shape. But that means all these, you know, hundreds of thousands of reservists are going to be subject to military law from... And also, the local commanding officer can refer a reservist to summary court-martial now. That's scary.
Thank you for joining us on Alternative Views. We'd like to give you the phone numbers for the Beyond War Foundations so you could contact those nice people. In Austin, it's 512-345-4698. In Palo Alto, California, that's their national headquarters, it's 415-328-7756. We'd like to thank some people. David Galasich, our director, camera people Judy Burton, Kelly Maddox, Brian Lynch. Our audio man was Richard Jones. Linda Borgeson did the editing. Terry Keene provided post-production assistance. We also like to thank Dmitry Devyatkin for making his documentary Video from Russia available to us, and of course, Austin Community Television. Alternative Views is a production of the Alternative Information Network, P.O. Box 7279, Austin, Texas, 78713.
Go around it in an hour and a half, you begin to recognize that your identity is with that whole thing. And that makes a change. And you look down there and you can't imagine how many borders and boundaries you cross again and again and again. And you don't even see them. From where you see it, the thing is a whole and it's so beautiful. And you recall standing out there, the spectacle that went before your eyes. Because now you're no longer inside something with a window looking out at a picture. But now you're out there, and there are no limits to it. There are no frames. There are no boundaries.
War is obsolete as a way of resolving conflict, and that we are one human family, and we need to learn to coexist together.
The cause of the arms race is war itself, and the root cause of war is the way we think.
El premio que generosamente
the prize we have been generously awarded enables us to unite as one, even though we are very far apart. It is perhaps a symbol that in spite of distance, We are together in a common enterprise.
La defensa del derecho más elemental de
the defense of our most fundamental right.
De nuestro derecho a vivir.
The right to live.
And you realize that on that small spot, that little blue and white thing, is everything that means anything to you. All of history and music and poetry and art and birth and love, tears, joy, games, all of it on that little spot out there that you can cover with your thumb.
War has permeated the history of mankind for thousands and thousands of years. Is it stoppable? What can we do to reverse this continuous trend toward war? This is the subject right now on Alternative Views.
Around the world can make a difference. Contact your elected officials today.
Good evening. This is the fourth and last in our series on war and what we can do to prevent it. We will emphasize tonight the positive aspects of what is being done, and particularly what the Beyond War people are doing. We'll see some very moving and touching documentaries which will really be very inspiring and hopefully wipe off some of the gloom and doom which we feel so much when we approach the subject of nuclear war. Barbara Carlson, the Texas coordinator for Beyond War Foundation, is with us still. Well, here's the positive aspect of what we can do. What is Beyond War doing in the country to try to eliminate the possibility of the Holocaust, etc.?
Well, as we've said in some of the former programs, Frank, we are educational. So we are trying to educate people about the need to change their way of thinking and realize that war is obsolete as a way of resolving conflict, and that we are one human family and we need to learn to coexist together. But I think some of the most hopeful statistics I can share with you would be just the response that we've had as we've educated in the last 4 years. This movement started in January or so of 82. Mm. And today there are people active in over 30 states of the United States. And we started with some 60 to 80 people. And today there are, well, at our last national meeting by satellite, we had 12,000 people participating around the United States.
That's terrific.
So you feel like, and I feel like in the work that I've done, that this is an idea whose time has come. You know, people respond when you go and talk to them. It's something that's in the back of their minds that they've had as a concern. And so to have the opportunity to sit down and to dialogue about it, and then to see a way to make a difference has been very, very positive. And people have responded in ways that we did not expect.
You were speaking of the media and the satellites. You had something called a space bridge. Can you tell us about that?
Yes, we did. We've done that a couple of times. In 1985, last year in December, we did a space bridge between seven nations of the world, including the United States. It's the first time it's ever been done. We connected the countries of Argentina, Tanzania, Mexico, India, Sweden, and Greece, and the United States by satellite. And we were able to do this in order to give the Beyond War Award to the five continent peace initiative, a group that is made up of the leaders of those six countries.
Well, you made a documentary on it, too. Why don't we take a look at that?
That would be great.
Okay.
It was the middle of the night in San Francisco and Mexico City, dawn in Buenos Aires and Stockholm, morning in Dar es Salaam and Athens, and noon in New Delhi. More than 1,000 people working simultaneously across five continents and 13 time zones began to make television history.
Okay, now we're here. Ladies and gentlemen.
This telecast is coming to you live from San Francisco, California, in the United States of America. I'm Craig Ritchie, welcoming you to this television global connection, which will, for the first time in history, bring together people from five continents and seven countries as the Beyond War Foundation presents the 1985 Beyond War Award to the leaders of the Five Continent Peace Initiative.
The Beyond War Award is given each year to the group, nation, or individual making the most significant contribution towards building a world beyond war. In 1985, the award went to the leaders of six countries who spoke out against the threat of nuclear war.
Well, we are together. We have made it all into one place. Ladies and gentlemen, the six leaders of the Five Continent Peace Initiative.
The six leaders were honored for the Delhi Declaration, a joint statement opposing nuclear weapons, opposing their testing, opposing the expansion of weaponry into space, and asking the world to join together in universal defense of our right to live. During the two-hour space bridge, each leader spoke to that point.
Leaders of Argentina, Greece, India, Mexico, Sweden, and Tanzania issued a call for nuclear test limitations and the reduction of strategic arsenals. This initiative shows the world that the arms race is openly rejected in every corner of the earth.
Then, each country gave a cultural gift as a vivid symbol of all that we need to preserve, which was sent by satellite to more than 156 cities across the U.S. and an estimated 100 million viewers worldwide.
The prize we have been generously awarded enables us to unite as one, even though we are very far apart. It is perhaps a symbol that in spite of distance, we are together in a common enterprise. The defense of our most fundamental right.
De nuestro derecho a vivir.
The right to live. meaning the non-nuclear nations, were the majority of the people of the world, are as involved and would suffer as much as the citizens of the nuclear weapon states. We therefore have a moral right to demand that the nuclear weapons never be used, that those who are responsible for them shall start a process of real disarmament. This process must start now, so that one day we will be able to see a future beyond nuclear war.
There is already a movement for peace in general and for nuclear disarmament in many countries of the world. But it's not global. And that's why my colleagues and myself decided to join this endeavor in order to make it global, not only engaging governments, but engaging millions of people, individuals in the world.
The issue is not only one of security. It is now one that has to do with the survival of humanity. The challenge of peace for nuclear disarmament is in front of us. We no longer have the luxury of waiting, of doing nothing. The time has come for the creation of a world without armaments, of a world beyond war.
We believe that nations, big or small, powerful or apparently weak, can and must live together in mutual recognition and trust. We believe that weapons of collective suicide cannot be the guarantors of a durable peace. Perhaps, in the ultimate analysis, ours is a faith founded in the essential goodness of human nature.
Also wanted to make a response here in the United States, so we would like to present you with our cultural offering today, which represents those 750,000 people who have pledged to honor and to support you.
America's gift was 750,000 signatures gathered in response to the six leaders' call to end war.
in 1948, Sir Fred Hoyle said, "Once a photograph of the Earth, taken from the outside, is available, a new idea as powerful as any in history will let loose."
Ignition sequence start. 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, 0. Liftoff. We have a liftoff. 32 minutes past the hour.
Thousands of people, almost 10 years, and billions of dollars to lift a human being into space. Russell Schweikert, lunar module pilot for the Apollo 9 flight, recalls the experience.
Around it in an hour and a half, you begin to recognize that your identity is with that whole thing. And that makes a change. And you look down there and you can't imagine how many borders and boundaries you cross again and again and again. And you don't even see them. From where you see it, the thing is a whole and it's so beautiful. And you recall standing out there, the spectacle that went before your eyes. Because now you're no longer inside something with a window looking out at a picture. But now you're out there, and there are no limits to it. There are no frames. There are no boundaries. And you think about what you're experiencing and why. Do you deserve this fantastic experience? Are you separated out to be touched by God, to have some special experience here that other men cannot have? You know the answer to that is no. You know very well at that moment, and it comes through to you so powerfully that you're the sensing element for man.
The sensing element. From that immense perspective of outer space, we can gain an insight into mankind's true relationship with the universe, with planet Earth, and with all life as we know it. A new perspective for all humanity, a perspective for what Einstein had called a new mode of thinking.
There you are, hundreds of people killing each other over some imaginary line that you're not even aware of, that you can't see. And from where you see it, the thing is a whole and it's so beautiful. And you wish you could take one in each hand and say, look at it from this perspective. Look at that. What's important? And you realize that on that small spot, that little blue and white thing is everything that means anything to you. All of history and music and poetry and art and birth and love, tears, joy, games, all of it on that little spot out there that you can cover with your thumb. You look down and you see that surface of that globe that you've lived on all this time, and you know all those people down there, and they are like you, they are you. And somehow you represent them. You are up there as the sensing element. And that's a humbling feeling. And somehow you recognize that you're a piece of this total life.
This sense of interconnectedness, interdependence, has been spoken of in every language and faith since the beginning. Buddhism.
自分に
害を与えるようなものは、
hurt not others in ways that you yourself would find hurtful.
Hinduism.
किसी से ऐसा व्यवहार न करो.
Do not unto others what would cause you pain if done to you.
Judaism.
Ma shesanu el reyacha.
What is hateful to you, do not do to others.
Taoism.
我邻人所获得的，也是我所获得的。
Regard your neighbor's gain as your own gain, and your neighbor's loss as your own loss.
Christianity.
All things whatsoever ye would that men should do unto you, do ye even so unto them.
Islam.
ایمان نیاوردید تا هنگامی که آنچه برای خود میخواهید برای
No one of you is a believer until he desires for his brother that which he desires for himself.
The genius of the ancients and the most modern scientific knowledge agree. The microcosm and the macrocosm are one interconnected, unified system. And we are one human family. We live on one earth. We breathe the same air, drink the same water. We have the same needs and hopes and dreams.
We travel together, passengers on a little spaceship, dependent on its vulnerable reserve of air and soil, all committed for our safety to its security and peace. Preserved from annihilation only by the care, the work, and I will say the love that we give to our fragile craft.
Before World War II in 1936, Pierre Teilhard de Chardin said, "The age of nations is past. The task before us now, if we would not perish, is to shake off our ancient prejudices and to build the earth."
I believe that we would be safer and that America would be more secure if we cut, and I mean this literally and absolutely, the defense budget by half arbitrarily today. And if we dismantled half of our nuclear weapons arbitrarily and unilaterally today.
Now, do you, as a statesman and a man that's obviously very concerned with this whole process and the question, do you ever sit down with your fellow leaders and talk about how do we actually live in a world where we do not resort to the use of weapons? Because I think that's one of the questions that people always ask us, is okay if we do that. Now, how is it going to work? We've never experienced a world in which we don't depend on defenses and weapons and all that whole kind of a system. What have you thought about that?
It will take time, and it's partly a conceptual question, because everything has been based so far on deterrence. You create fear in your opponent. You make him aware of the terrible consequences if he would attack you. And to some extent, this is functions. I won't deny that. But deterrence is becoming obsolete, because you could never use the nuclear weapons. To my mind, are completely useless. I can't envisage a situation where anybody could use them. The only risk is it's really by accident or by mistake. So therefore, deterrence becomes like a drug. You need stronger and stronger doses to make it work, and in the end it doesn't work at all. Or it leads to the ultimate catastrophe. And then we have to have a different way of thinking. And we have said to ourselves that the two superpowers, they are very adversaries in many, many fields, but they have one thing in common, and that is the will to survive. And they want to see their children and grandchildren live, and they want to see their country develop. I'm sure of that. But they can only survive together. And that's a fundamental fact. They will never be in the situation to destroy the other without being themselves destroyed. And on that is a starting point for something positive. So this means that you in the future, you will not be able to build your security against the other. You will have to build it together with the other. You will have to find the sort of common denominators which will make the world livable and more secure for future generations. And that's a very conceptual starting point. And we have tried to in this small country, to develop this idea of a common security for all. And that is beyond war.
What evidence do we have that the Russians are really ready to make significant negotiations towards arms reduction?
Well, there was quite recently a suggestion that we would sit and discuss the problem of the theater nuclear war. Mm-hmm. And we are ready to reduce our middle range missiles in Europe if NATO will not go for this Pershing 2 and Trident program, mm-hmm. a new program. So I think this is a good thing. And there was also the suggestion of a moratorium or a freeze.
Freeze.
Yes, freeze immediately followed by negotiating mm-hmm. Both strategic armaments and theater nuclear armaments, which, by the way, psychologically for a lot of Russians are also strategic mm-hmm. because middle-range missiles in Europe, American, mm-hmm. for example, they can reach Soviet Union.
Right.
Our middle-range missiles cannot reach the United States. But, you know, this definition we can let strategists and military experts, mm-hmm. you know, deal with. What are strategic, what is theater nuclear missile? The main thing is to reduce all of them mm-hmm. as soon as possible. And in this, for this, we must build up trust, you know, mm-hmm. step by step. I meet sometimes people who just demand immediate and absolute reduction, which I think is impractical. We must go step by step, building up trust. More trust we have, better we go in this direction.
You've been talking about ideas and changing attitudes and all. You have some background on the effectiveness of this when certain percentages of people change their attitudes. Can you tell us about that?
Mm-hmm. Well, we tried to make some studies of social changes that have occurred in the past and how they have come about and the role the individual has played in that change and the numbers of people involved and the number of people it takes and so forth. And one of the interesting things we discovered, and this is from some research that a man at Stanford did, Everett Rogers is his name. He says that if you can embed an idea, a new idea, in 5% of the population, it will never go away. It will always be alive and well and living. And so that is the first thing that we're trying to do, is to embed a new idea, this new way of thinking in 5%. Then if you can get that 5% to be active and involved and educating others and doing things, you have the potential to grow it to 20%. And when 20% of a population hold a new idea, it becomes unstoppable. It becomes the new way of thinking. You don't have to convince everybody. It's the idea of the creative minority.
And what would be some of the examples in which this was actually taken place? Things like civil liberties, civil rights movement.
Mm-hmm. Women's liberation.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
The two that are the most meaningful to me, and I, you know, just remember the one, and that is the civil rights movement. Mm-hmm. You know, the individuals that made a difference, the most inspiring is to just think about Rosa Parks, that little black woman sitting mm-hmm. on the bus, and she just had had it. Her feet were tired, and she just decided she wasn't going to get up off that bus, the front seat of the bus. And as a result of that, Martin Luther King was able to launch this whole bus boycott that absolutely just changed everything. And then all of the blacks that cooperated to not ride those buses for all those months. So you can see how key individuals were.
In 1982, a movement began in this country, born out of people's overriding concern that life would continue on this planet only if people changed their thinking about violence and war. This is the story of that movement, of the growing thousands of people working together to build a world beyond war.
The Hiroshima bomb was 12 and a half kilotons. For one megaton on Los Angeles, I am trying to ask you to try to imagine 70 Hiroshima explosions occurring simultaneously at one point in time at one place.
We have about 30,000 nuclear weapons in the United States military forces. The Soviets have about 20,000, total of about 50,000 nuclear weapons. And the number in both countries are increasing.
The diversion of the huge resources that go into weaponry leaves far less available that could improve the duration and the quality of life for much of the world's people and lift the burden of privation and the burden of despair that envelops many of them.
A large part of the problem is confusing nuclear weapons with security or military capability.
What is happening in this country is that most people are practicing heavy psychic numbing. They're pushing it back and they're not thinking about it. And in fact, one psychiatrist talked to me in London and she said she thinks what it is manic denial.
They just don't want to know that they can't survive.
In the early 1980s, there was a tremendous change in the public concern about the arms race and about the threat of nuclear war. Physicians, scientists, religious leaders, arms control experts, and people all over the planet were coming to the realization that if those weapons were ever to be used, we as a species could become extinct. Beyond War began at that point. We began by researching the situation. We talked to experts in many fields on all sides of the issues. And we became convinced that the problem is not a technological one, and that the solution is not technological either. The cause of the arms race is war itself. And the root cause of war is the way we think. At that point, we set about to discover how do you build a world beyond war. We interviewed thousands of people from California to the nation's capital. And from that emerged the goal and philosophy of Beyond War.
And so the goal of the Beyond War movement is to gain consensus around four points: that nuclear weapons have made all war obsolete, that we live on one planet with one interdependent, interrelated life support system, and we all make it together or we all die together, that there is a process for changing the modes of thinking, and it begins with a personal, individual decision. And there is a plan of action that requires the participation of all of us to build a world beyond war.
Then we launched a course called An Orientation to a World Beyond War, which helped people to clarify the problem for themselves, and then to take action, to take a positive action to get beyond the problem, beyond war. We gathered women from 34 states and 7 countries to call for an end to war.
Isn't it exciting and hopeful to have nearly 3,000 women here for a woman's convocation on Beyond War, a new way of thinking?
And thousands of men gave new meaning to Armistice Day.
As men, we have created and we have perfected war. And as men, we must end it.
And Beyond War workers began to talk and talk and talk for audiences all over the country.
We are capable of anything that we make up our mind to do.
One of the things that I find most impressive about the Beyond War people that I know is that some of them have been so concerned and dedicated on this issue that they have simply picked up and moved. And that speaks to me of a profound dedication.
To get their message across, 20 families have left their California homes to take up residence in 11 other states. In this quiet neighborhood of Wellesley, Massachusetts, a new movement is underway.
This is a movement that concentrates on the root cause of war, which is the way people think.
The strategy appears to be working. Already, the Helps, traveling through Massachusetts, have reached about 2,500 people.
Dave Buzik.
Good evening. Iowa is one of 11 states that's been targeted by a national movement called Beyond War.
Not all of their work involves such large groups. Most of what they do takes place at small meetings, like this one in the Thomas's Clive apartment.
This chart portrays what that one submarine can do.
And it seems to me that Beyond War is right on target in that the grassroots are going to be behind it this time.
We're having orientations and intros throughout the city. Just the people's participation and interest in it has been really exciting.
And in raising the awareness is what's important. And to do that involves a personal commitment.
It is not an anti-movement, if you know what I mean. It's a movement that says, let's go from the positive. Let's work together to create a different way of thinking.
The compelling aspect and the nature of the issues here caused the most conservative people to open their eyes and to make the decisions to get involved.
The women who gathered in Tigard today were also concerned about nuclear disarmament and how to stop global conflict. In a symposium called Beyond War, more than 600 women from three states jointly vowed to change the nation's attitude toward war.
We've looked at marketing research where they've said if 5% of a population takes a hold of an idea, then it becomes embedded in that society. And then if you reach 20%, it's an idea that's unstoppable.
The Beyond War Award was designed by the people of Steuben Glass and was created to honor the great efforts of humankind as it works to build a world beyond war. To help in choosing the recipient each year, we named a Beyond War Award Selection Committee composed of distinguished men and women from around the world who by either their talk or their writings or their speeches had demonstrated an awareness of the need to build a world beyond war.
In 1983, the award was presented to the National Conference of Catholic Bishops for their historic pastoral letter, The Challenge of Peace, God's Promise and Our Response, which courageously addressed the question of war. In 1984, the recipient was International Physicians for the Prevention of Nuclear War. IPPNW represents more than 100,000 physicians worldwide who are educating others about the need for a new way of thinking. Dr. Yevgeny Chazov of the Soviet Union and Dr. Bernard Laun of the United States accepted the award in the first live teleconference between Moscow and San Francisco. In 1985, the award went to the Five Continent Peace Initiative in a historic satellite link-up of seven countries with two-way live television.
Well, we are together. We have made it all into one place. Ladies and gentlemen, the six leaders of the Five Continent Peace Initiative.
Another multinational peace initiative by Beyond War occurred at the UN.
We have to primarily identify with the system that we call this planet our home, that we share in common. The Charter of the United Nations can't really any longer afford to be a dream. It says United Nations. And we have to think of our planet that way. And we are here to make that appeal to you, the people who are working in this country to build a world beyond war. We will work here, and we will make changes in this country, but we can't do it by ourselves. We can't do it alone. We count on you and all the people you represent to help us move, change. We have to move forward and look forward to what we have to do together.
Encircling the globe with live satellite space bridges is just one of the many ways that Beyond War is moving into the international arena. After an exploratory trip to Japan, it's clear that at the right time, Beyond War has a real contribution to make there. Our Beyond War presentation at the United Nations, featuring Dr. Carl Sagan and Sergei Kapitsa of the Soviet Union and Richard Rathbun, has built new relationships with representatives of a dozen countries. A Beyond War group has begun in Canada, and in-depth weekends are now taking place in West Germany. We are one, and it's only when the people of the world agree that we are beyond war that national policies will reflect that reality.
Beyond War says that not only must we change our way of thinking since the splitting of the atom, we must change our way of acting.
Their outreach efforts are extraordinarily successful. The reason for it is the caliber of the people involved, their obvious dedication, the fact that they are willing to devote their lives to this endeavor.
It's an organization composed of imaginative, constructive, productive people who've dedicated themselves to creating a new frame of reference.
It's people. People build a world beyond war. People make the difference. Together we face a huge task, but if each individual does something, like Yashiko Hashimoto, who single-handedly brought Hiroshima television to Beyond War, and Beyond War to Japan, like Charles House, who is teaching a Beyond War course on old modes and new modes of thinking. Like Linda, whose beautiful Beyond War billboards are being seen today all over Northern California. Like Herb and Jean Drake, who had an idea about communicating change, so we have the excellent publication on Beyond War.
Good afternoon, Beyond War.
It's the hundreds of volunteers in the national office here in Palo Alto and in offices all across the country.
Even though thousands of people are working very hard, we all have a huge job ahead of us. Together, we're taking on a job that has never been done before, and we are just beginning. We know we have a lot to learn, but we also know that with the right attitude and with the commitment to get this job done, we can and we will build a world beyond war.
Barbara, we want to thank you for spending this time with us and also providing us with the wonderful documentary programs which we've featured for the past 4 weeks. And keep up that good work. Keep changing those minds.
No, it was a pleasure to be here. Thank you for having us.
For more information about the Beyond War Foundation, write to 222 High Street, Palo Alto, California, 94301, or call 415-328-7756. In Texas, 512-345-4698. During this past series, we haven't always had time to roll the credits so you can see who was responsible and participated in these wonderful documentaries that were presented to you. So we'd like to do that now, interspersed with comments by Dwight Eisenhower and Douglas MacArthur.
This special program was sponsored by Beyond War, the Commissioner of the New York Commission for the United Nations, and Ambassadors to the United Nations, from Canada, Brazil, Kenya, Austria, Sweden, West Germany, Yugoslavia, Thailand, the Soviet Union, and China.
monarch in the world, or any nation in it, hope for if no turning is found on this dread road. The worst to be feared and the best to be expected can be simply stated. The worst is atomic war. The best would be this: a life of perpetual fear and tension, a burden of arms draining the wealth and labor of all peoples, a wasting of strength that defies the American system or the Soviet system or any system to achieve true abundance and happiness for the peoples of this earth. Every gun that is made, every warship launched, every rocket fired signifies, in the final sense, a theft from those who hunger and are not fed, those who are cold and are not clothed.
My mom once, she came into my room and she heard me talking in my sleep saying, "No bomb, no bomb, no bomb." And I'm just worried that I might die, and I don't want nuclear wars to happen.
In the first program on our four-part series, the segment with Dr. Robert Bowman talking about Star Wars was made possible in part by the Department of Defense, the Foundation for the Arts of Peace, and Physicians for Social Responsibility.
We have been compelled to create a permanent armaments industry of vast proportions. Added to this, 3.5 million men and women are directly engaged in the defense establishment. We annually spend on military security alone more than the net income of all United States corporations. Now, this conjunction of an immense military establishment and a large arms industry is new in the American experience. The total influence, economic, political, even spiritual, is felt in every city, every state house, every office of the federal government. We recognize the imperative need for this development, yet we must not fail to comprehend its grave implications. Our toil, resources, and livelihood are all involved. So is the very structure of our society. In the councils of government, we must guard against the acquisition of unwarranted influence, whether sought or unsought, by the military-industrial complex.
A lot of people participated in making Beyond War a mini-documentary in the first part of our series. Here's a list of them. In 1961, after his long military career was over and nearing the end of his life, General Douglas MacArthur had this to say: "You will say at once that although the abolition of war has been the dream of man for many centuries, every proposition to that end has been promptly discarded as impossible and fantastic. But that was before the science of the past decade made mass destruction a reality. The argument then was only along spiritual and moral lines, and lost. But now, the tremendous evolution of nuclear and other potentials of destruction has suddenly taken the problem away from its primary consideration as a moral and spiritual question, and brought it abreast of scientific realism. It is no longer an ethical question to be pondered solely by learned philosophers and ecclesiastics, but a hardcore one for the decision of the masses, whose survival is the issue.
But above all, the people. I like to believe that the people, in the long run, are going to do more to promote peace than our governments. Indeed, I think that people want peace so much that one of these days governments better get out of their way and let them have it.
We hope you've enjoyed this four-part series on war, on alternative views. We have a lot of people to thank who made the production possible. Our director, David Galasich, camera people, Judy Burton, Kelly Maddox, and Brian Lynch, our audio man, Richard Jones, and our post-production assistant, Terry Keene, who spent many hours wading through videotapes to find just the right quote to fit into the program. And our biggest kudos and appreciation to our editor, Linda Borgeson. She put in many, many hours over many, many weeks and months to bring this program to you. Our equipment was provided by Austin Community Television, ACTV. And obviously, we couldn't have done this series without the help of the people in the Beyond War Foundation. Linda Lieberman, who made the initial contact with us and told us about the organization. Catherine Kramer Lewis, who gave us orientation on the organization and put us into contact with Barbara Carlson, who did our interview with us. Alternative Views is a production of the Alternative Information Network, P.O. Box 7279, Austin, Texas, 78713. If you'd like to contact us, you may reach us at this address. We'd like to hear from you. Goodbye.